Well, good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to Future Point of Views update number 5 this year. Today's topic is data privacy, preparing for more regulations, because that's just what we need, right? It's more regulations. We do these updates. We do about 8 a year. We try to pick really interesting topics and kind of give updates on those. So we've got 3 more the rest of this year. So if you're interested in those, go to our website at pov.com. and sign up for them. My name is Scott Brady. I'll be co-presenting today. I'm here with my cohort, Corey White.
Hi, and this is a topic I am really fascinated by, data privacy. So I'm excited for the next 90 minutes. Hopefully we learn a lot. We're gonna go through a lot of content really quickly, and we're really only gonna scratch the surface on this complex topic, but we hope that you learn a lot and able to learn a lot for your organizations as well. I'll let you get us started, Scott.
Or we'd be here for 90 hours.
Oh,
right?
Yeah.
Instead of 90 minutes, right. Right.
Yeah,
so let's just kind of go over what we're going to cover today. We've got several topics that we are going to cover, but we're going to kind of go over how we got here. And, you know, all the data that we've been collecting over the years and all the breaches that we've had recently that made all the news. So we're going to kind of go over that. We're also going to go over why you should care about this. You know, leaders need to care about what data privacy and how they handle data. We're also going to talk a little bit about GDPR and CCPA. Got some updates on that as well. And a little bit on what's coming down the pipe on data privacy regulations. So we're also going to talk about a few different organizations that have been impacted by this. And then challenges of remote work. You know, with the COVID this year, remote work has gone to all new heights. And so a lot of organizations have scrambled, one, to be able to do more work remotely, but then there's a lot of data security issues as well. So we're gonna kind of go over that a bit as well. And then, you know, the best ways to navigate through some of these regulations as well, we'll kind of cover that at the end. So we do things a little differently here at Future Point of View. So during this presentation, go to slido.com right now, slido.com. When you get there, it'll ask for an event code and just type in data privacy. We're gonna be pushing out about 8 questions throughout the hour and a half. And so please vote on those and we'll talk about those as we go. There's also a place, if you have a separate question, go in there and just type in a question. If you have a question, we'll get to as many of those as we can during the time. Don't wait till the end. We'll kind of address those as we go.
And you can go on your phone. You can also go on your device as well if you're watching from a laptop. But if you want to keep us up on the big screen, and then go on your phone, and you can answer the questions on your phone as well. Good. Well, it's how we got here. Scott, I think that's where we need to begin. And this is an infographic from Information is Beautiful. And it does a great job in articulating really how we got here. And you'll look at this video, and it starts at about 2010. And each bubble is a breach of a significant size. And you see these bubbles get bigger. They get bigger and they get more prevalent as they go. And as you move into 2018, 2019, and 2020. As you can see, these breaches are becoming bigger and they're becoming more, they're bigger and they're more prevalent. And that is really because, well, we're putting more and more data out there, right? And so there's a reason why. So a lot of identities have been stolen in these breaches. And our first Slido question that we wanna ask you, if you go to slido.com and hashtag data privacy, we want to ask you if you personally have been the victim of identity theft. And a lot of people have been the victim of identity theft. And three of the reasons why are these 3 big hacks. The first one we'll talk about is the Office of Personnel Management. You may remember this one. It was in 2013 and 22 million records were stolen. The Chinese government got into their system and they were able to steal a lot of when they were targeting people with security clearances and people had gone through background checks. And there's obviously a reason why. That's information a government may want on American citizens. But of course, they didn't just get people with security clearances. They got family members and friends, because the government was collecting information about these people as well as they were doing these background checks. And the second, Anthem. 78.8 million records in this Anthem breach, and a lot of really sensitive information was lost in that breach, including social security numbers and dates of birth. And then finally, maybe the most famous identity theft or the data leak in history, Equifax. 143 million records in 2017. And Equifax was really a case study in how not to handle a data breach. They pretty much bungled that, and a lot of people, it impacted, oh man, maybe half of the population in America. I know I was one of the people that was impacted in the Equifax breach, as a lot of people were. I went in and went to their website and was able to find out that actually, yes, indeed, my information was in that breach. And so Americans have seen these corporations really mishandle their data. IBM did a study in 2020 about the costs of a data breach. And what they found was that a data breach costs $3.86 million per breach. That's what they found. And it's a little bit less for organizations under 500 employees, $2.64 million per breach. And per customer PII, it was about $150 per record. So these data breaches are very costly, and they're not only monetary costs, but reputational costs as well. And the reputational costs are growing because individual citizens are becoming more aware of their data and what organizations are doing with their data. And the second Slido question we want to ask you is, has your organization in the last 5 years suffered a data breach? So go to Slido and go ahead and ask that question, or go ahead and answer that question.
So the first one, about 25% have suffered a breach so far that have answered on that question.
Really?
Yeah,
wow.
25.
Wow, that's a breach or identity theft?
The identity.
Okay, identity theft. About a quarter of people have been the victims of identity theft. This is a quote from Marissa Mayer. She's a successful, very talented and smart businesswoman in Silicon Valley. She's also the former CEO at Yahoo. And she had a quote. And that quote was, "With data collection, the sooner the better is always the best answer." And this is pretty much, I think, what traditionally Silicon Valley has thought about data. It's like, we need to collect as much data as we possibly can. Let's just grab data as much as we can and not really worry about the repercussions. And we're starting to rethink that. And many of the reasons why we just talked about it is the fact that these giant data hacks have happened, these giant hacks and data leaks, and people are beginning to be concerned about how companies are handling their information. Now, there's a study from Pew Research that 7 in 10 Americans said in 2009 that their personal info was less secure than it was 5 years earlier. So you're beginning to see that Americans as well are worried about their data privacy. You think about, if you look at the legislation between GDPR and what we have in America, what you might think is that Europeans are less worried about body privacy and more worried about data privacy, while as Americans are more concerned about body privacy but less concerned about data privacy. And that's just not the case, as you'll see in this Pew Research study. Americans feel that they are not really getting a benefit from the information that governments are collecting about them, and companies as well, I should say. And finally, a majority said that the potential risks of data collection outweigh the benefits. And we're going to ask you a third Slido question. And that question is, are you concerned about your own data privacy? So on a scale of 1 to 5, how concerned are you about your own data privacy? Scott, I know you're a big fan of the Starbucks mobile app, but you're a big fan of Starbucks in general, but were you a little...
But I don't drink coffee.
Yeah.
Just for the record, I love Starbucks, but I like the tea.
Yeah, but you're pretty impressed with the amount of information their mobile app is collecting on people.
Yeah, I was surprised about this. I'm like most people, I didn't really read the data privacy statement when you agree to download an app, but when you go in there and dive into the type of things that they're able to do, now they don't... It gives them permission to do some of these things. It's not necessarily that they do all these, but your location information, if you have that turned on in the app, and we're going to talk about that here in a minute, but if you have that turned on, they can monitor your location all the time. In fact, a couple of years ago, they've quit doing this now, but they used to, if you were driving about the same time of the morning on the same road that you were going by a Starbucks that you frequent, it would pop up, would you like, and it would pop up whatever the last drink you ordered through the app. It would pop that up and say, would you like to order that? So they don't do, you know, the geofencing, they still do around the, when you get close to the stores, but they don't do that on when you're on your trip anymore. And you know, part of the thing, Corey and I were talking about earlier today about geofencing is really going to be in the news a lot coming up. There's a lot of court cases coming up on geofencing. The police are really starting to use the geofencing. And I'll give you an example. When there's a crime committed, let's say they rob a convenience store at midnight, the police department is asking Google most of the time on, can you give us all the information that you have on all the devices that were at this location at midnight, at you know whatever time the robbery was. And to Google's credit, they are protecting our identities a bit because they're giving them anonymous data to where it doesn't show whose device it is. It just shows what devices were there. And they put it back on the police department for them to come back and say, okay, what specific devices are you interested in? So anyway, just keep an eye on that, on the geofencing. There's going to be a lot of court cases on that coming up and how that's going to affect us because a lot of organizations use that.
Scott, one thing about data privacy, and this is privacy, it's a balance between privacy and convenience. Mm-hmm. And we do those stats, up front. You see those studies about how concerned Americans are about data privacy. And they can be a bit misleading, as some people would say, because, of course, when you're asked, are you concerned about your data privacy, you're going to say, yeah, I'm concerned about my data privacy. But what it really is are you showing that you're concerned about your data privacy? Are you taking the steps to ensure that your privacy is being maintained? And a lot of times we're not as a population. And these organizations have to find that balance between privacy and convenience because we talk about this thing here called the technology halo. Or the digital halo, right? And it's how can you as an organization make your efforts, your customer experience efforts so good that really the customer thinks you know them, that your services are so good that they think they know you or you know them. And the only way to do that is with data, right?
Data activation. Yeah. That's what this whole data activation is.
So when we talk about data privacy, we're not saying don't collect anything. Although it may seem like it at times, but because you need to, and marketing departments need this data, and people want this data, you to take this data in many cases, because they want you to serve them most effectively. But a lot of times what we're seeing is people are taking this data and then they're using it in egregious ways or ways that they were never agreed to or a customer never agreed to.
Or they're selling it.
Or they're selling it. And so you think the Starbucks, this is another example of one that you saw, right? This actually came to your mailbox.
Yeah. So this was a financial institution that I have an account with, and we've all gotten the disclosure of the privacy in the mail, and it's 3,000 words. In fact, I downloaded Microsoft's privacy statement, and just the data privacy statement was over 3,000 words, but the user agreement was over 16,000 words. So clearly we're not reading all of that. But I thought this was interesting on how this financial, what these guys did is they, on the front page of their data privacy statement, had this table that showed what it kind of paraphrased all the words, so you didn't have to read all the words. So, for example, it showed what data we can share and what data you can limit us to sharing. So you, where you can opt out. Most of it we had to, I don't have a choice. So if you look at those first four, they share the my data, but I don't have a choice. But you get down to where they're working with their affiliates, then I have a choice where I can opt in and say, I don't want you sharing my data. So it's interesting that, and hopefully more organizations will start doing something like this to make it easier for us to understand.
I think you will see that. And as we will get into GDPR and CCPA, you'll see that one of the main tenets is that you have to be clear in your consent. You have to be clear and not with this legalese about exactly what you're collecting on your customers and what you're doing with right. that data. This, I don't know if you all are you know, fans of mobile gaming, but a lot of people are. These are really popular mobile games, Farmville and Words with Friends. Highly popular, highly addictive, used by millions of people. And here's just some of the information, according to NordVPN, that these games are collecting on their users. And I mean, do you think a mobile game needs all this information? Probably not, right? Right? A mobile game to allow you the functionality to play. Now it may need some of these things. It might need your friend's contact information so it can connect you with your friends. You know, but it doesn't really need your approximate physical location, right? There are certain things that this, in the functionality, what you need this thing to do, that it doesn't need that information. So our next Slido question we're going to push to you in a second is going to be essentially, when you download an app on your mobile phone and your device, do you check the permissions? Are you aware what that is collecting on you, what that app is collecting on you, and what it's doing with your information? I know Apple's a little better at this than Android. I'm an Apple guy, so I'm not really quite familiar with what Android's doing in this world. But I can, you know, go to my settings in Apple, and I can. They're pretty good about me allowing me to restrict, you know, what kind of information I'm allowing these mobile apps access to, whether it be my camera, my contact list, or other types of information. So our question to you is, you know, do you go into your settings and really adjust those things and take a look at what these mobile apps are actually collecting about you?
So here's another example of another app, GasBuddy. If we were doing this live, I would ask everybody to raise their hand how many of you use this app. But I started using this several years ago, did not know that they were monitoring all my driving habits. You know, and to talk about it today seems a little silly because most of us probably have our insurance company, car insurance company, where they're monitoring that anyway, and they offer you discounts. I know the company I'm with does that and monitors that. But when I downloaded this app, I didn't realize that that's what they were doing. They were downloading my driving speed, my acceleration, my braking habits, you know, all kinds of things like that. So, you know, we don't read the data we're allowing them to access, and so we just need to be more careful on that and start reading that.
One thing too is that this is kind of the future, right? When you think about insurance,
yeah,
this is where we're headed, right?
We're here, yeah. I mean, most of the big auto insurance companies are already doing this and they offer you, and they offer you discounts if you. It tracks how many times you drive over 80, how many times you hard brake, and then I'm sure there's an algorithm that figures out what kind of discount you're going to get if you don't do all those things.
Yeah. So and it can be important to consumers to maybe save some money.
Sure.
You know, again, that balance between convenience and privacy and being able to offer consumers things that that they want.
Yeah.
They want, but you have to be careful with how you're sharing that information.
Yeah.
We got to talk about TikTok, of course. You know, they're in the news right now. And I don't know if anyone here saw this Reddit post, but a Reddit user says he broke or reverse engineered the TikTok app. And this is what he alleged, or I say it's a he, the user, could have been a she, but alleges the app was collecting. So, TikTok, again, like I say, it has been in the news. It has become a political issue at this point. A lot of people love TikTok, and I'm not saying don't go use it. But what I'm saying is that TikTok is not really collecting any more information than maybe a Facebook would, or probably, I mean, not really. There are some things that have been concerning. I was something actually this morning as I was driving to work, I was listening to a podcast where they were saying TikTok was actually on the iOS app, was at one point in time was collecting all of the information on your clipboard, which is a bit concerning. And then when that was discovered, TikTok said, oh, we won't do that anymore. Well, the problem with this, and that's not unlike, you know, some of the other apps we've seen here in America that have kind of been caught red-handed collecting data they probably shouldn't have been collecting. I mean, of course, we, you know, think famously about Cambridge Analytica with Facebook. But the problem with TikTok in many ways is who might have access to that data? And of course, that is the Chinese government. And we just can't be sure if TikTok, although they say we don't share any information with the Chinese government, history does not really indicate that it doesn't bode well, because the Chinese government right now, obviously with the things that they're doing with the Uyghurs and the surveillance state they're building out there, there's a lot of concerning things about these apps that are built in China and maybe collecting data that could be shared with the Chinese government, data on American citizens.
Before you go on, Corey, the last question on, do you limit the permissions? 25% of our poll results so far said they do it all the time.
That's interesting. Well, now we're going to get into the fun part, the talking about the GDPR and the CCPA. We did just post a new Slido question, and we want to find out, how prepared do you think your organization is right now for things like the GDPR and the CCPA on a scale of 1 to 5? How do you feel your organization is prepared for these data regulations? We're going to start with GDPR. It's probably one of the most famous acronyms in the world right now. And it came to effect in 2018. So if you haven't begun preparing for it, you probably need to. And it involves any citizen inside the European Union. So any citizen in the European Union falls underneath GDPR. I think it's important to talk about first the key players, so you understand kind of when we use some of this lingo, what we mean. First is the data subject. And the data subject is anyone who is giving you data. If you are what we call the data controller, they are a person who own their data, and they are giving you some piece of information about themselves in order for you to provide a service to them. And that, of course, that what we give them, that information, we call data. And that's any type of information, most especially personally identifiable information. So that might be name, email address, social security number, but it could be things like an IP address as well. And then there's the data controller. As an organization, that's probably you. You are taking that information that the subject is giving you, and you are using that to provide them a service. Maybe it's to send them a newsletter about some of your services. It might be to send them goods, more especially today, because we're doing more and more online. It could be that they give you an address so they could send them something, or maybe they give you some personal information about their T-shirt size, right? So you can fill that good and you can send it to them. And then finally, you have the data processor. And that is a third party that you use to help you provide that service to this data subject. So that could be a website, like a web host, so like a WordPress, right? It could be a WordPress, or it could be like a MailChimp, or somebody you use to send out content, a CMS of some sort. That is the data processor. They are processing data on your behalf. So really, first thing you do is you pick, obviously, a data processor as the data controller. Some organization, some entity that you're going to use to process that data. The data subject is going to give his or her data to the data processor through, like, let's say they go to the website, they fill out a widget that gives you their email address through this third-party data processor. And then finally, that processor sends that information back to you so you can fulfill that service. So some of the changes that GDPR, some of the major things, the major tenets of GDPR is, of course, the scope. And it applies to all EU controllers or all EU citizens. And it involves any controller or processor that is processing or has control of any data of an EU citizen, no matter where that organization is housed. So they don't necessarily have to be located in the EU. They just have to be processing citizen data, EU, European Union citizen data. So essentially, if you have a website, more than likely you are in some way collecting data on an EU citizen. The penalties for breaching for GDPR, for falling in outside the scope of the GDPR, in violation of the GDPR, I should say, is 4% of annual global turnover or your annual revenues or $20 million.
Hey, Corey, we do have a question.
Okay.
Someone asked, they've always wondered when an app asked for permissions, can they view their camera and does the app have access to their photos?
That it depends on what the app has decided. And the question is, does this app have access to cameras or photos? And yes, it very well can, if you give that app permission. And sometimes, especially in the past, you didn't even need to give that app permission. As long as you downloaded the app, it might still have access. And like I said, the phone companies, and I know Apple is doing a better job with this, and I would imagine, again, I'm not an Android guy, but Android is as well, as doing a good job of being able to allow you to control what permissions you allow each app. So if you go to your settings, i.e. on an Apple device, you can look up what each app has access to. And you can see, why does my flashlight app have access to my photos and videos? There is absolutely no reason why a flashlight app should have access to my photos and videos. So then you can turn that off. And if you can't, then you need to obviously remove the app. So it's just a matter of like auditing and going, and just like you're monitoring your credit card. You look at your credit card statement. When you download an app, it's a good idea just to take a look and quickly just figure out what that app has access to on your phone. We talked earlier about consent and about the legal ease. And it is important under GDPR to make sure that you're clearly defining for the people who you are processing data of exactly what you're collecting on them and what you're doing with that data. There's a thing called dark patterns, and I don't want to really get into it too much, but it's kind of neat if you look it up. And it's kind of the creative ways that organizations will use. You think about like a subscription service. So they make you jump through hoops when you want to remove that subscription, right? All you want to do is remove. You just say, I don't want the subscription anymore. Well, if they can make it 2 to 3 times harder, you're not going to go through the effort, or you won't go through the effort for a couple of months, and they're going to collect that money. And if you think on that by millions of dollars or millions of users, that's millions of dollars for them. If they can get you just to not unsubscribe for a month or two. So that you have to be clear about how you're using the data, and you have to make it easy for people to understand what you're doing with the data. Breach notifications. You must notify regulators 72 hours by 72 hours after you have figured out that you have been breached. It's not 72 hours after the breach occurred. It's 72 hours after you discover that you've been breached, that you've been the victim of a data leak in some sort of way. So really, a part of this seems kind of scary, right? But it's not meant to be scary. Like if I do 73 hours, all these regulators are going to come get me. the point of all of this is to create rules, but it's also to really figure out those people who are egregiously violating their subjects' rights, their data privacy rights. And that's who the regulators are going to come after. You know, if you in good faith are trying to be a good steward of people's personal data, and you can show that, yeah, we made a mistake, or yes, we were leaked, we were the victim of a data breach, but here's the steps we've taken to try and keep customer data safe, and here's what we did to notify customers, here's what we've done to make sure that, you know, people know that their identity, that their information might be out there. If you could prove that, then the regulators are going to offer some grace. The data subjects have right to access their data. So they have the right to reach out to you as an organization and say, what data do you have on me? And where is it, and what are you being used for? And if you get an access request, you have to provide that information in a format that they can read. So it might be a Word doc, where you reach out and you collect all of the information you have on that subject, and you send that subject that information in a readable format. So you have to do that under this regulation. And EU citizens have the right to be forgotten. So you if an EU citizen says, you've got some data on me and I want that removed, you have to remove it, unless it violates or some sort of public interest. Obviously, there's certain information you think about, a sex offender who, wants an organization not to publish that he's a sex offender, but it's in the public interest. That might be an example of where right to be forgotten might not apply. Organizations must offer people, their data subjects, the opportunity to take their data and move it to a different controller if they wish. So you have to be able to give your, essentially, again, access. You're giving the data back to that data subject. You have to design your systems for data minimization, essentially. So you're only processing the amount of data and controlling the amount of data that you need to do the task that you've been asked to do. Nothing more. If you don't need that data to do the task that you've been asked for, you probably shouldn't be collecting that data or processing that data. And that is what data minimization is all about. Finally, data protection officer. A lot of organizations are now required to have data protection officers. Think about universities. You think about hospitals. You think about people who collect a large amount of data on EU citizens, or really sensitive data, really unique data, like law data. That's the type of people that need to have data protection officers. Organizations as well might want to think about at least considering getting a data protection officer as well, but we'll talk about that later. Do we have a question?
Yeah, we do. So the question is, will the slides be available later? So this will be posted on YouTube, so you can go watch this at any time.
Okay.
Correct?
Yeah.
So we'll do that. The other question is, are there apps that alert you to third-party apps when they access and provide you the details? I've only seen Apple ask me occasionally about GPS things.
You know, I think I've read about that. Maybe there's apps I know that makes a consent a little easier now, that they're able to parse these giant privacy policy statements. I don't know if you've heard of any.
Yeah, no, I don't know of an app that monitors all of that for you, but Apple is starting to do that a little bit for Apple devices.
Yeah. They're doing a better job because it's become such an important issue at really making sure that when you download an app, it's very cautious about what that app is able to look at, what that app is able to access on your phone. And Apple is a little better traditionally at this than Android because of the market. Apple's a little bit more of a closed app store than the Android app store is traditionally. So. But they're doing a better job, both are at monitoring and allowing you and informing you of when the apps are egregiously collecting information on you. And I think that's only going to get better. But there are going to be, you do see those apps. I mean, the gaming apps, the flashlight apps, those are the examples. You know, you get these flashlight apps that are collecting these just insane amounts of data, or really doing these shady things. That's going to happen. That's going to continue to happen. So you really want to monitor when you download an app. Why am I downloading this app? You know, a lot of people just like to download apps, right? And you know, you need to think about, why am I downloading this app? Do I need this app? And then, is it reputable, right? What are the, how many others have downloaded this app? Can I go online and read about what this app is and what it does? Like, if I need to download, let's say, a flashlight app, I'm going to go online before I just downloaded the first app I see. I might go on and make sure the app, is not scamming. And it's not going to do things like send me spyware and things like that. So we look as leaders at the impact of data privacy. And we could look at it as a, I got to do this. You know, I don't need this right now. This is going to cost me money. It's going to cost me time. I just don't have time for it. The truth is that it is an investment in your business, and it can return. There can be a return on this investment. As you can see from this Cisco 2020 Data Privacy Benchmark Report, for every dollar investment in data privacy, companies are seeing $2.70 return on their investment. And some of the ways that they're seeing this is customers are seeing value in organizations that are protecting their data. So they're more likely to be loyal to those organizations that they know will take their data and treat it with its proper respect and consideration. It also, when you are breached, if you're using data minimalization, that breach is not going to be nearly as bad. And you're going to be able to more effectively respond when there is a data breach and notify people. And finally, you're more attractive to investors as well, right? Investors, when they're looking at your company, they're starting to look at your cybersecurity practices. They're looking at your data privacy practices, and they're saying, you know, should I invest in this company? And if this company can't keep their customer data safe, then I probably don't want to be a part of this company. I don't want to be associated with this company. So here, the chief privacy officer at MasterCard said, forward-looking companies are making data privacy an important part of their brand, right? It is an important part. It has become an important part of these brands and how they do business. Scott, we think about things that have come across the pond, right? You think about the Beatles, right?
Okay.
You think about pizza. I mean, I like pizza.
Sure.
It's an export, right? I think.
Sure.
Yeah. French toast.
Yes.
Yeah. Is French toast French? There's some really good things that have come across the pond, right?
But not GDPR.
From Europe. I don't know. I don't know. I mean, I guess it's into the eye of the beholder. But eventually, America had to come to terms with GDPR. And you knew when you see things like Equifax, it needed to come here to America, and now we just have a mishmash of state regulations.
Including California.
Yes, yes. And Scott's going to talk about that.
So let's talk a little bit about CPA, but Corey, I do think you should have done that whole GDPR with an English accent. I thought that would have been a little bit better.
More of an Irish accent. So you see my complexion? Yeah, I'll break out. Bloody hell!
So, thanks, Corey. So when you talk about CCPA, most of us have heard of it, hopefully. It passed back in 2018, but it didn't go into effect until January 1st of this year. And all of the fines didn't start until July 1st. So we're now just starting to see the enforcement, and we're already starting to see some issues. There's two large companies that have already been written up, and they're in the discovery stage of Walmart and Salesforce. Both are in litigation right now over CCPA violations. So we'll wait to see on what happens on those, because it just started happening. But when we talk about CCPA, what does it really mean, and how does it apply? So if you do business in California, California, this will definitely apply to you. If you have annual gross revenues of $25 million or more, also, if you possess the personal information of 50,000 or more consumers in your database, and then if you earn more than half your annual revenue selling consumer information. So Corey keeps bringing up the flashlight. The companies like that, all they do is collect data to sell, and that's their revenue stream. So they give you the flashlight for free, but they're selling the data. So now all four of these aren't ands. It's not California business and possess 50,000. This is or. If you do any of these, then you fall under CCPA. Now,
and Scott, like GDPR, doing business in California doesn't necessarily mean that you have a location in California.
100%. Yeah, 100%. And the annual gross, so the law is a little ambiguous, and it's going to be interesting to see how the courts handle this. The annual gross revenue in excess of $20 million, does that mean I got to do $25 million in California, or is it just my total revenue? So that's going to be interesting to see how that goes.
You know, I think it's interesting to talk about how this law was enacted. And I'm paraphrasing here, but in California, it's pretty easy to get a law in the books. So some privacy groups got together and they created this really, I'll use the term draconian law. And that would have been really onerous on California, on businesses in general. And then so a law was fast-tracked to try and get ahead of that law that was a little easier on businesses. But they didn't do any zero discussion with organizations, with people who would be affected. It was really just kind of thrown together. So there's a lot of things that are still going to be figured out. And there's a lot of things that we'll talk about later that may come in the future. But a lot of this stuff, too, is going to be decided in the courts.
Yeah.
It's going to be decided by legal battles.
Yeah. And we'll start seeing that here in the coming months. The Walmart one is probably going to be the first one settled, and Walmart is fighting it too. So it'll be interesting to see how that goes. So the law also talks about the rights of California citizens. They have a little more rights than most of us as far as our data and what can be collected and whether it can be sold. It has to be disclosed. So there's a lot of different types of things in this law that people, like, for example, people can say no to their personal information being sold. We don't usually get asked that, but under California, the CCPA now, they have to be asked that at any time that wants to be, their data needs to be sold. Also, if a company is going to access personal information, they have to let them know that as well. So California citizens have a few more rights than the rest of us, but you know, a lot of us talk that this is probably going to become federal. Some version of this is going to become federal at some point, whereas a lot of other states right now have something that's similar to this, but nothing is near as complete as the CCPA yet.
Yeah, and I mean, they talk about New York and New Jersey are two of the probably most famous cases outside of California that we talk about when we talk about these things. And a lot of these laws, you know, everything in the last 3 or 4 or 5 months has kind of been pushed aside. Now, regulation is still continuing, but these laws moving forward, because everybody's kind of worried about this little thing called COVID-19 that we're all worried about. But, you know, the other thing is most organizations aren't selling data, right? They're not selling information. And so, yes, you have to be wary of the CCPA, and this should... You should be concerned about data privacy, and this is something that you should be taking a look at if you haven't already. And you should make sure things like your privacy policies are up to date. But you need to know that these are targeted at people who are egregiously misusing data or using it in a way that you kind of go, no, I wouldn't want my data used in that way.
Right.
So you have to keep this in mind that this is scary, but at the end of the day, you're not going to have regulators knocking down your door tomorrow.
Sure. Okay, so some of the other CCPA requirements, companies have 30 days to comply. If they get written up, they have 30 days to comply. If not, the fine is up to $750 per record. So that can get expensive pretty quickly. Individuals now have the right under this to sue individual to sue the companies about their data being breached. So that's what we're seeing in the Walmart case right now. Individuals are suing Walmart. So it's going to be interesting to see how that all works out. And here's a big one. This is an easy one to get done at your company. Is you have to have a visible footer on the bottom of your webpage, at the bottom of your website, that gives the consumers option so they can opt out of the data sharing. So that's an easy one that we all can do, but it's something that we're seeing a lot of the large organizations do, but a lot of the medium-sized and small haven't done that yet. So we may need to make sure we get that done. Now, under CCPA, what's considered personal information? So this is a big one. And it's really ambiguous here as well. And we'll talk here in a little bit about there's a CCPA on the ballot in November in California to help clarify some of this. But this personal information isn't just your name and email address, social security number, driver's license number. We're talking about biometric information, geolocation information, professional or employment information. There's a lot of different types of information that fall under this CCPA.
You know, Scott, that when you look back at that, and it's amazing how forward-looking that is. When you look at some of the things that are on that list, they're looking forward into what are people going to collect in the future. So there are things like facial recognition, but there are things like smell. Like smells, olfactory, they called it. And so the idea that this information, more and more, we're going to be giving more and more of our information out there. And a lot of this is biometric data, right? And it's data about ourselves that really we can't change. I've broken down biometric data, I think, into two different categories.
Can we give the poll results of the last question?
Yeah, let's do that.
So about 25% is saying they're not very well prepared for GDPR and CCPA.
How many say they are prepared?
About 30%.
Okay, yeah. So about half and maybe, yeah. About half says, yeah, they're not prepared, half says, yeah, they are prepared,
yeah,
and then about the other half say somewhat.
So 50% say they're not prepared, 30% say they are, roughly.
Okay.
Yeah.
Not prepared. Okay.
Yeah.
Interesting. So, and we'll ask you here in a few minutes how this has changed, maybe your feeling on how prepared your organization is. But when we talk about biometric data, I've broken up biometric data into two different types of data. And the first, when you think about engagement behavior, and that is the way you engage with your device. So it might be your digital signature. It could be the way you use your hand, the gestures you use on your device, the way you move your mouse. There's even the way you type. And authenticating devices more and more, getting into devices and logging on, they're using that. They're able to see the way you type or feel the way you type, and then know it's you and authenticate you that way. So there's engagement behavior, and then there's physical characteristics. So you think about facial recognition and any photos and videos that can identify a person. And facial recognition is just such a hot topic right now. I'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. But fingerprints is probably the most famous example of physical characteristics. It's the way a lot of us are using to open up our phones and our devices. But there's also voice and there's gait, the way you move, because we all move in a way, and that the way we move can be used to identify ourselves. And then finally, DNA as well. That's a biometric data point. This is an interesting study I saw recently. It was by a university in Finland, and they were studying the way we move and the way music affects the way we move. So they were trying to say, why do we move in this way to rock and roll? And why do we move this way to a different type of music? And they were using machine learning and motion capture cameras. And inadvertently, this study found that they were able to identify a subject through the way they move with 94% accuracy. Wasn't even trying to study that, but figured that out. Pretty amazing by just the way that person dances. And I know, Scott, you can pretty much identify me by the way you dance, and it's not pretty. It is not pretty the way we dance. But they called it motoric fingerprints. So that may be a new way to a new type of biometric data. We may be able to add motoric to it, and that would probably involve gait as well. So gait and things like the way we dance and the way we move. I don't know, a lot of people have begun taking these at-home DNA or ancestry tests. A few years ago, they were really popular Christmas gifts, right? They were, you would get it for your mom or dad so they could take it and they could figure out, you know, their lineage. This was a study from last year, but 26 million people, roughly, so it's more than 26 million people, have taken these at-home DNA tests. But when you take these tests, right, when you offer up that data gets stored in a database somewhere. That data goes somewhere. And that database, as we've seen, is vulnerable, right? If a database full of credit card information and social security numbers is vulnerable, a database filled with DNA could be vulnerable as well. These companies have been the targets of cyber attacks. And nobody's gotten into a database of DNA as far as I know. But you can imagine that these criminals are trying. Why? Because that's information that they would want about you. Because that information cannot be changed. You can alter your name. You can change your social security number. You might be able to go and have surgery and change your face, but you cannot change your DNA. So we're going to push one more Slido question to you.
Pushed.
And really, it's about facial recognition. And it's about if law enforcement had your facial recognition data in a database, and they were using that to identify you potentially if a crime had occurred, would you feel like that is an invasion of privacy? Would you feel so? We're really fascinated by this question. Scott, I know you, I am fascinated by algorithms, and especially facial recognition algorithms. I speak a lot about algorithmic bias. It's a topic I'm very passionate about. And it's a topic that is top of mind for a lot of people in the technology space right now. There was a report of a police department in Detroit, in Michigan, who had arrested a man based on a facial recognition ID. And that man was arrested, and they realized after they arrested the guy that it wasn't him, that they had identified, the facial recognition software had identified the wrong guy. So the guy had to spend the night in prison, I believe. He had to pay a bond of $1,000. And the police department could have figured out easily that this wasn't the right guy, that they had the wrong guy, but they didn't do the effort. What they did was they relied on the facial recognition software, and they said, okay, the facial recognition software has identified this guy. This is our guy. Let's go arrest this guy. They didn't do any other police work. What they would have found if they had done police work was that the guy had posted on Instagram, it was a shoplifting charge. So the guy was charged with shoplifting. And what they would have seen as the exact moment that this crime had occurred, the guy had been on Instagram Live singing in his car. And all they had to do was go on his social media handle and figure out that he was had an alibi, or just ask the guy, where were you? But they immediately believed that this facial recognition algorithm was right. And that's a problem that we're seeing a lot in technology right now, is that people have a tendency to believe technology, that it is fallible, that it doesn't make mistakes. when in fact technology can make mistakes. And that is one of the reasons why we still need human oversight when it comes to technology. We need humans looking over these technologies, because these algorithms, if they're fed with wrong data, if they're fed with data that is what we call dirty data, which is bad data, or maybe data that's uneven. So maybe one set is more of one set than the other. That's why in many ways why facial recognition algorithms in Western society struggle to recognize African-American faces, because they're fed data from the internet. And the internet is very white-centric. And so in countries like Asian countries, these facial recognition algorithms do a great job at recognizing Asian people, but they do a worse job recognizing people of other ethnicities. It's an interesting topic. I kind of went on an aside there, but we would like to know what are your thoughts about facial recognition and law enforcement.
About half of them feel like it's an invasion of personal property or personal privacy.
Okay.
About half of them do.
And more companies are starting to recognize this. We've seen recently a few companies have decided. Major players have decided totally to get out of the facial recognition game, and others have decided to wait a year. Let's give it a year. Let's not do anything. And cities, we're starting to see cities who are starting to ban this technology. We're starting to see schools where it was being implemented that are kind of starting to take a step back and say, maybe we need to rethink this. And it's that balance between security and privacy, right? We all want to be secure. If it could stop a school shooting, we want that. We want it to stop a school shooting. But if it's going to cause a confrontation between a police officer and a person who has been misidentified by a facial recognition algorithm, and that confrontation turns deadly, we don't want that. So it's an interesting balance. Scott, you talk a little bit about, because 1.0 isn't boring up to dead. 1.0 isn't enough.
Yeah.
We need 2.0 as well.
Yeah, so this is what I was referring to that's going to be on the ballot in California in November. Now, if we didn't have another election that's getting a little bit of the headlines, this might get a few more headlines, but it's probably going to get pretty well go unnoticed. But what they're trying to do with the CCPA 2.0, if you will, is to give a little more clarity to the law. And there's some interesting things. It's giving more, a greater protections for minors. It's defining more about what our rights around sensitive data are. So there's lots of different types of information that they're going to limit the use of, because it's going to fall under this sensitive and personal information. So there's lots of different things here, as you can read here. You can go and look at this later and take a picture of the slide, or you can take it now. But they're just trying to clarify the law quite a bit. Now, when we got a question earlier too from JDub. Now, we have a client that we refer to as JDub as well. So I'm not sure if it's him or not, but he brought up a good point on the biometric. It would be good for online testing for schools, so like the ACT or SAT, and online voting. So that could be an interesting, that's an interesting observation. So thanks for that. And yes, Gas Buddy does rock, he mentioned. So.
Yeah, he was also mentioning that having your location services on could be your digital alibi. So, I mean, that's interesting. And it is a way that, we think of it, we could track criminals,
right?
But good guys too. It could be an alibi of saying I was here instead of there. Like I say, there is a lot of people who say, well, I'm not doing anything wrong, so I'm not worried about being tracked.
Right.
Because why would I worry about being tracked if they know that I went to work, to home, went to the gym, went to dinner.
But Corey, you're boring. So yeah. most people may not have that same view.
Yeah, I'm saying. And there's an overt tracking too.
Right.
And what we need to be careful of, I think, are some of the things that are happening in other parts of the world with this technology. And as a society, we need to, as an American, as a democracy, we need to promote freedom and values with this technology.
Yep.
And I will say that. I know it might be controversial, but I'll say that we need that. That needs to happen. We as a country, we need to lead with this technology. And we as a Western, and I say Western, or those who want freedom and democratic values need to be leading when it comes to technology and not allowing authoritative governments to lead when it comes to these technologies. And that may be one of the defining things of this century. We're going to go over some case studies now. And this is one that happened recently, and you may have heard about it. Blackbaud, and what Blackbaud is, it's a management system for a lot of nonprofits and universities, and they use this information as donor management systems and things of that nature. Well, in July, they announced that they were the victim of a ransomware attack, but the attack had occurred in May, right? The attack occurs in May. And details like names, gender, date of birth, contact details, addresses, those things were involved in the breach. But they didn't notify customers for nearly a couple of months, right? What they did was they tried to negotiate with the attacker instead of notifying customers. I know that some big names were involved in this. I know here locally, the University of Oklahoma had to send out a notification to their to people. I know some other nonprofits here locally. I know the Boy Scouts were one of them. I think the University of Texas was involved in this as well. So it was a huge deal. And what Blackbaud said is that, well, we negotiated with the attackers, and we paid the attackers a certain amount of money, and the attacker gave us back the data. Well, of course, you don't really know if the attacker did make a copy of the data. I mean, there's really no way to understand that data has fully been destroyed. Additionally, this may have put those nonprofits and those universities into the crosshairs of GDPR, because they could be the controllers of this data, right? And that is why it is so critical, and we'll talk about it in a minute, to ensure that your third-party vendor contracts are ironclad, right? That you know that when something like this occurs and a processor loses your data, that you are not on the hook by that data subject. That data subject or regulators can't come after you because of a mistake or some mishap that happened by a third-party processor. This is a company called Plaid, and Plaid is the essentially between like a Venmo and your banking, your account information. They connect the Venmo to the bank account through that software. They were hit recently with a $5 million class action lawsuit. What the class action lawsuit essentially says is that Plaid is looking at user banking information and looking at all the information, the banking history, and then mining that information and selling it to third parties. So essentially, it's staying up to date on every move that you make. And what the lawsuit says is that in Europe, it doesn't access bank account information because of things like GDPR, right? So it's not accessing your bank account information in Europe, but it's doing so in America. And if it can still get the job done in Europe by not mining bank account information, then it should be doing that in America. Again, it's the data minimalization piece, right? It's the idea that we only need to be doing with the data what we need to be doing to do the service that we have been tasked to accomplish. This came into my inbox a few days ago, actually, and told me I was a part of a class action settlement because I was one of the 8 people in the world who had a Google Plus account.
Yeah, I got that too.
So we have 2 of the 8 right here.
Weston is much cooler than me, so I'm kind of shocked he had a Google Plus account. He's also much younger, so I'm actually surprised. Weston, and he doesn't really have a social media presence. But yeah, so Weston and I could have gotten $12 a whopping $12 if we had decided to be a part of this class action lawsuit and decided to jump through the hoops to actually retrieve that money. It was $7.5 million settlements. I think more and more we're going to be seeing things like this. Like, we're a part of these types of settlements. You're going to start getting notifications more and more that says, hey, your data has potentially been breached. And then more and more, you're maybe going to get a small stipend. And you think about Equifax, and when these things happen, they have to offer data monitoring to people. But, credit monitoring, I should say. But I think more and more we're going to be seeing things like this.
So, Corey, we've been talking a lot about breaches, and most of these are online breaches and digital breaches, correct? And we just want to point out that these privacy regulations and fines and problems that you could have, it isn't just digital. You know, it could be, you know, you get broken into and they steal some of your files. There's different types of things. You could print out something, a sensitive document, that somebody picks up that shouldn't have it. Or how many of us have hit send on an email and you're doing a request real quick and you send it to the wrong Scott, right? You know, instead of the right person. So if we send an email and it's got some sensitive information about our organization, these violate privacy regulations as well. So we don't want you to think that this is all digital issues. These are, some of these things can involve paper as well.
Absolutely. I remember hearing a story, I believe it was a hospital in Europe somewhere, might have been in like Ireland, who could fall under GDPR, could come into the crosshairs of the GDPR because they had some files had blown out the window and they lost some medical records, some paper medical records had blown out the window, right? And they could have come afoul of GDPR. So we're not just talking about digital data here. We're also talking about paper. So it's just a thought that you need to maintain your paper records as well and do a good job of maybe if you don't need them anymore, burn them, right? Burn them or shred them. Unless you need to keep them for some sort of legislation or legal reasons. So now we want to talk about some ways you can protect your organization from these types of regulations. And really the best way is to move from reactive cybersecurity to proactive cybersecurity. In the past, we need to say, eventually we're going to be part of a data breach. It's going to happen. We're going to be hit in some way. Every organization is going to get hit in some way. So we have to move to what happens when we get hit, not if we get hit, but when. So we're being more proactive. And the first thing we're doing is we're mapping our data. And how you create a data map is this. It's just a visual blueprint of all of your data. Now, if you go to a data privacy lawyer and you say, what is the first thing I need to do to figure out where I'm vulnerable when it comes to CCPA? CCPA 2.0 is coming. Where am I vulnerable? That data privacy lawyer is going to look at you and he or she is going to say, have you mapped your data? This is something we do. We go in, we interview your people, and we are able to create a visual diagram of all of your data, where it's stored, who is processing it, how it sits in transit and at rest, who has access to that data. You can see all of that in these visual blueprints, and then you're able to see where your vulnerabilities lie. So that is the first step. You need to map your data. The second step is creating what we call digital event response playbooks. And what you're looking at is a playbook for a stolen device. So this is a device that more and more this is happening because we're all working from home. You leave a laptop in your car and that car is broken into, that device is stolen, and that device had data on it that was unencrypted and that data was sensitive. What do we do? Most organizations are like, oh my God, I don't know what I'm going to do. But with a playbook, you know exactly what you're going to do because it's going to give you a step-by-step guide to exactly how you respond to that event. And it's more than just a stolen device. We have them for data breaches. We have them for a lot of other type of, I think we've 30 now, Scott, something 30, like that, yep. 30 digital events that we have playbooks for. First thing is a decision tree, deciding, do I need to run this playbook? So you go through this decision tree. Maybe you don't need to run it. Maybe you do. And then you go into the guide. And from when you detect that that event has occurred to when you have remediated the event and you're kind of going back through your post-mortem, all of that is mapped step by step, and each department in your organization knows exactly what they're going to do in each specific step. So IT, legal, we talk about corporate communications. If there's a data breach, how is corporate communications going to reach out to customers? Or how is PR going to reach out to the media if this is a bad enough event to where we need to run some media? We're going to have to contact the media because they're going to be contacting us. How are we proactive about these events? How are we communicating? How are the departments communicating with each other? And where are those moments of truth? Where are those moments that if we screw this up at this moment, it could be deadly? And we're running tabletop exercises. And what those exercises do is they give everyone in the organization an opportunity to run through the playbook. And then they get to practice and you get to see where you're weakest. And that means that you have an opportunity to, in those first critical moments, when these things occur, when most organizations are sitting around and they're going, I don't know what to do. And everybody's looking at each other and you're stumbling over each other, trying to figure out what to do. You're not doing that because you have mapped out exactly what you do in that scenario. Other ways to prepare the organization. This is one of the basic ways is every once in a while, you want to update or review your privacy policy. You want to do this periodically. You want to look at your website privacy policy and say, am I up to date? And am I adhering to the regulations? And a privacy policy is essentially just telling consumers what you're collecting on them, why you're collecting that data, and what you're doing with that data. And obviously, if you're selling the data under CCPA, you need to provide those opt-in, opt-out things. But at the end of the day, it's really just about being transparent with the consumer. It's not rocket science. It's just being transparent with the consumer. And just letting them know, because that's all it is. It's transparency. We just want transparency between the organization and the data subject. We want to review our third-party vendor contracts. Make sure that you know exactly who is responsible when these types of events occur. When a data breach occurs, how responsible are you? Who is responsible for notifying the customers? Who is responsible if you get sued, if regulators come knocking on your door because of a data breach, who is responsible? You want to make sure you understand that and make sure these contracts adhere to these new regulations like GDPR and CCPA and the other things that are coming down the pike. You want to segment your data, especially consumer information. So PII, I think PII needs to be segmented from the rest of your data. And you need to make sure that only the people who need access to that data have access to that data, right? It's data minimalization. It's making sure that we are only allowing people access to the data that they need to do their jobs. And that is especially true with customer information. You want to try and anonymize your data wherever you can. Make sure that your data cannot identify a person, right? An individual person, because you do not want that data to go out where if there's a couple of three or four segments of data that can be pulled together to identify a person, you just want to make sure that you're anonymizing it so that can't happen. You're probably not going to get a flood of access or deletion requests, especially in the data, probably the people in this organization. It's not something that's going to happen, but it could happen. You could get a person reach out and say, what kind of data are you collecting on me? I want access to that data. And then they could reach out to you and say, I want to delete that data. So we're just preparing for it. Like I say, it's not going to happen overnight, and you're not going to get a flood of them, but you want to be prepared. You want to be proactive, because more and more this type of stuff is going to happen. And it's probably not going to happen if you are doing your job correctly. And your job is really just collecting the data you need to provide that customer service, right? only the data you need to provide that service to the customer. You're going to want to complete an application and data security assessment. So you want to go in and you just want to assess, where are my vulnerabilities in my applications and my data security? You want to do that periodically, have a third party come in and just audit you and look at those applications and that data and say, where am I vulnerable and where do I need to shore up my patching is an important part of this as well. Making sure that third party applications are always patched. Those cloud software, make sure you're constantly patching those things. You want to develop a data retention policy if you don't have one. How long should we keep the data? Now, if data, it's legally obligated to keep it, you want to keep that data. Now, yeah, obviously, if you're legally obligated to keep it, you want to keep it. But if you're not, and then you're not using the data, well, you might as well destroy it. If you don't need it, and you don't need it for because you're using it or because you're legally obligated to keep it, then you might as well get rid of it because it's only going to hurt you if it gets out. And then consider a data protection officer. Not all organizations need one, but it might be important to have one. And when you in cybersecurity, you know, when we were building cybersecurity departments, a lot of organizations looked out and they said, you're good at technology. You know the network. You can run our cybersecurity, right? That's what they did. But what you need in cybersecurity is you need a person who understands cybersecurity. Now, there are a lot of very smart technical people who run networks. I'm not saying they can't do the job, but cybersecurity is so important that you need somebody with some expertise in cybersecurity. Same thing with data protection. You can't just look and say, well, you kind of know what data we have. I think you could protect it. You want to have somebody who knows what they're doing, and you want to have somebody who's not beholden to leadership or to marketing, right? So somebody in marketing says, I need to collect this data because we're going to do this. And that data protection officer has no teeth, right? Or the leader goes to them and says, well, I have a great marketing department and they need to, you know, do this. So give them access to that data. And then the data protection officer can do nothing. That's why you want to use an outside consultant. You want to use somebody who's not beholden to the organization. Scott, we've kind of had this unprecedented time called COVID-19, mm-hmm. and it's changed the way we work, and it's changed the way we protect data. So organizations protecting their data during this work from home event, what are the things they need to know?
Yeah, so there's a lot of different things that organizations are struggling with. You know, when the COVID thing first hit and we sent everybody home, to work from home, a lot of organizations struggled with just having the right infrastructure. Can we communicate properly? So they tried to get that. They weren't even thinking about data security. So, you know, the thing we have to think about is we have to properly train our employees on some sort of security awareness training. There's a lot of options online. There's a lot of different inexpensive ways to do this, but it's very important to train our employees on this. The second thing is, employees, when they're working from home, don't let your family members play with your devices. You know, we hear story after story after story. You know, a parent at home puts down their device to go answer the phone, or they're cooking, and a kid picks up their device and downloads a game or some app, and it's a shady app, and then they get access to the company that way. So you just cannot let your family members use your work devices.
I think, you know, that is a great point. And also, you know, kids, they don't really understand what they're doing, right? They don't know. They're not doing it because they want to be malicious. Yeah. They just don't understand. Sometimes, you know, they go to websites maybe they shouldn't go to. You know, I was a teenager once too. And you know, if it's on your work device, you certainly do not want that your leadership finding out about that. And the other thing is, if you've got sensitive information, it could be a violation if they're able to look over your shoulder at, you know, that information. So we have to be really careful about the information we allow to leave the organization, right?
For sure.
Like, and making sure that people that don't have access, you know, a family member maybe doesn't have access to a customer social security, right? Yeah. That's, we absolutely don't want that
yeah. happening. By the way, we pushed another question to the poll, so be sure to go to Slido to get that as well. All right, so another point on protecting your data on work from home is utilizing a VPN if you can. If the organization can add a VPN, that just adds another layer of protection to the devices. The next one here, Corey, is this is a big one. A lot of the larger organizations do this well, but being able to wipe a company device remotely. So if an employee goes rogue or if a device gets stolen, being able to wipe that device remotely. You know, we see a lot of mid-sized organizations and small organizations don't have this ability. So you need to take the extra step to be able to do this, especially if we're having our employees work from home, there's more data available to them. And restrict the apps that employees can download on their work devices. My wife works for a Fortune 100 company, and they are very locked down on what they can download. If there's an app that they want to, that they feel like they need for their job, they actually have to go make a presentation to the IT department to get permission to download it if it's not in the approved list. So just restrict what employees can download to their work devices. And ensure the employees know how to keep devices secure. You know, don't leave them in a car. You know, cars get broken into all the time and devices stolen. So don't lay them down when you're at the grocery store to find your credit card. People lay their cell phones down right on the counter. Just be very careful of your devices. And then ensure that your employees, when they're not at their home, if they're in a public place, you know, don't go to Starbucks and use their public Wi-Fi and download information from your, you know, like payroll information for your company. So we just got to be smarter than that. So those are just some tips on the work from home. You know, that's kind of a big deal right now. So we just wanted to make sure everybody had a few tips on work from home security.
And that was the poll question that we just pushed, just because we want to kind of understand, you know, what, how, you know, your, how, you know, how effective your data privacy practices have been during this work from home scenario. Now, this is something I saw on Twitter a few years ago, and I really liked it because it's kind of funny to me, and I use it on a lot of my cybersecurity talks. And we do employee awareness training as well, and that is one of those things that you need to constantly be doing. If you're a leader of an organization, right, is you need to be constantly training your employees on social engineering and the ways they can avoid these techniques, whether it be phishing, spear phishing, vishing, business email compromise. You need to be constantly training your employees so they know where the attack vectors are, what they look like, and they know to avoid them. And more that is so critical because these employees are working from home and the attack surface has grown so much.
60% say they're not very effective work from home.
From home.
Yeah. The data practices.
Yeah. I think that's pretty normal. We, it came so abruptly. And a lot of organizations were prepared for it. And a lot just were not. And eventually, I think we're coming into, people are getting more settled, and this is going to be the new normal, right? When it comes from work from home, it's going to be, employees probably are going to work in a hybrid model, right, Scott? What we've seen is that employees more and more don't necessarily want to work full time in an office. But they also don't want to work full time at home because they want some of that structure. They want to be able to have some contact with the outside world and with their employees. And so you're probably going to be working in some sort of hybrid model in the future, more than likely. Smaller organizations may work totally from home, but more likely there's going to be some hybrid models. So all of those tips are pretty important. And this is something I did see. In the future, everyone will want to be anonymous for 15 minutes. And I think it's pretty appropriate, you know, because we're being tracked so much. We're being a lot of our data is we're being, so much of this, I'm reading a great book called The Age of Surveillance Capitalism right now currently, and it really elucidates the ways that these big companies are tracking us. And when you think about this biometric data that is coming, that is becoming more and more prevalent, we talked about facial recognition technology, but that stuff is, and maybe there's going to be another look at that technology, but it's not going away, right? At the end of the day, the cat is out of the bag. That technology is too good. Things like that, it's too good. It's too good for law enforcement. Eventually, it's going to be too good for retailers who are going to have the opportunity to maybe see when somebody has come in their store and know exactly what that person wants and maybe be able to have that that goods or services waiting. Maybe if that person walks into the store, you've got five or six dresses already waiting for that person that that person might want to try. And that person might appreciate that. That woman who's trying on dresses might appreciate that she can walk into the store and you have five or six options for her waiting for her that she might like. That's going to save her time, and she's really going to appreciate that, right? So at the end of the day, these technologies aren't going away, but it's how you use them effectively and how we use them to be respectful and to our customers and to be appreciative of our customers' privacy while also helping to build that digital halo. That halo that says that we are using technology effectively, that we are using it in a way that makes your customer experience better, that makes our product, our goods, our services better than our competition because of the way that we use technology. How do we do that in a way without invading somebody's privacy?
Yeah, well said. Yeah, thanks, Corey. All right, so we pushed out the final question for the on Slido. And now that you've gone through this update, how safe do you feel and how prepared do you feel for GDPR and CCPA? So answer that question. We appreciate everybody's attendance. And go ahead.
We've got a few minutes, Scott, so I kind of want to give maybe some, if you've got some thoughts about great resources for people who are interested in data privacy. I don't know if you've seen him. You and I both really enjoyed a podcast called Caveat.
Yes.
The Caveat podcast. It's put out by the CyberWire. They do it once a week with Ben Yellen, Dave Bittner. A really great podcast if you're wanting to get up to date on what is going on in data privacy legislation. If you're kind of a wonk like me and you kind of, you're not a lawyer, but all of this stuff is pretty interesting. To me, it's an interesting, if you're a podcast person, I would say go ahead and download that. And it's about 40 minutes.
Yeah. And it's great. And you go back, they've got several episodes you can go back and listen to. One of the guys, I can't remember, I think it was Ben, is the lawyer. One of them is an attorney.
Yeah.
And so they give you a unique look at some of these cases. And so, yeah, go check that one out for sure. That's a great resource.
Yeah. Yeah. And then I mentioned the book, The Age of Surveillance Capitalism, a really great, great book, a great read. So, it's a long one, and but it goes into the history of this, what the author calls the age of surveillance capitalism and how we got here. So it's definitely an interesting read. And I know we've got a couple more updates we want to talk about, Scott, from over the next year, right? The first is on September 9th, machine intelligence. I will be a part of that, and Scott Klazowski, the founding partner of Future Point of View, we'll talk about the machine intelligence stack and the different layers of machine intelligence. And I think I'll geek out a little more on algorithmic bias as well, because it's just such a fascinating topic to me. And Scott, I think you're involved in this one.
Yes.
The blockchain case studies.
Yeah, so the blockchain case study is going to be a little different. We're not going to talk about what is blockchain. I mean, we probably have all seen that ad nauseum. We're actually just going to talk about case studies that work. So it'll be an interesting one. You can go to our website to sign up for any of these. But in this blockchain one, it's only going to be case studies that have implemented successful blockchains. So come to that one in October.
That's kind of one of those technologies that have kind of fallen off the radar recently. But it, it's still, we're kind of the segue of technology, right? We're not quite sure if it's going to be good. We don't know if it's quite a segue. Some people think it's going to be a game changer, but it definitely has some practical implications as well. FPOV.com, go to our website to sign up for that. And again, we appreciate you. For Scott Brady, Corey White, thanks for joining us.
There was one.